Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And I shall see my God, whom I shall see for myself. Mine eyes shall behold, not another. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear unto my cry. Hold not thy peace at my tears. For I am a stranger with thee, and a sojourner, as all my fathers were. O spare me, that I may recover strength before I go hence and be no more. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, and even before, thou hast formed the earth and the world. Even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night. They are as asleep. The morning they are like grass which groweth up, in the evening they cut down and withereth. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. We ask that you would join us as we sing a hymn of the church, Hold to God's Unchanging Hand. Remember, we're here to celebrate the life of Eugene. Time is filled with swift transition. On things eternal.
Build your hopes
on things eternal.
Hold to God.
Come on, you better hold.
You better hold to his hand. God's unchanging hand.
You better hold to his hand. God's unchanging hand.
Build your hopes on things eternal.
thank those of you who are with us here on today, and we have come to bless the name of the Lord, and in the midst of doing that, celebrate a life that was well lived. So we ask that you would follow in this order. We will have our Old Testament scripture by Reverend Walter Longshore, our New Testament scripture coming from our evangelist, Jerry Ann Andrews. In that order, please.
The 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still water. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me to paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup is running over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. I've been reading 1 Thessalonians chapter 14, chapter 4, verse 4. Praise God. Hallelujah. Mr. Bingman, I can do this. Chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that we sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we shall are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Verse 18, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. May God bless his written word.
Amen. Thank you for those scripture. Now is the time that we come to pray. And we believe that the prayers of the righteous availeth much. We have been in yet much prayer in constant communication with our Lord and Savior. And at this time, we invite our deacon chair, Deacon Cynthia Numacoro, to lead us in prayer of comfort.
Giving reverence to the Holy Spirit, the angel of this house, Pastor Platt, Mother Betty, her family, and all God's children gathered here. Good morning. Let us meditate on the words in the book of Isaiah, chapter 41, verse 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. During our marriage vows, we say in sickness and in health, till death do us part. Mother Betty, you have truly, truly been the best wife, companion, caretaker, for Brother Eugene could not have ever asked for anyone better. You stood by his side every step of the way. For 57 years, you held to your vows. You are a shining example of what us young brides are supposed to do. You have our most deepest condolences. May God continue to give you the peace that surpasses all understanding. Let us look to the Lord. Father, we thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. Through these times of anguish, may we all discover a clear vision of hope. We are grateful for your divine faithfulness. You know how much we depend on that. Your promise is secure, for you said in your word, I will never leave you or forsake you. Lord, grant that perfect peace beyond human understanding, peace of her heart and peace of mind. You are a shepherd, ever with us when we pass through the valley of the shadow of death. Be now with the one we love, our dearly beloved Mother Betty. We release her to your care, Father. In your way and in your time, take hold of our dear one and give us all your blessing for peace and courage. Jehovah Jireh, there is none like you. Every day we want to praise and worship your glorious name. Today we weep at the death of our beloved Brother Eugene. Father, but you said in your word, weeping endures for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Blessed Father, Mother Betty can rest assured knowing you are there for her and her family, knowing they can find comfort and peace within you in the midst of their tears and their grief. Lord, we shout praises because you have turned their mourning into dancing. As she continues on, Father, we pray to you, her Alpha and Omega, her beginning and her end. You be a bright flame before her. You be a guiding star above her. You be a smooth path below her. You be a kind shepherd behind us today, tonight, and forever. Remember her, O Lord, in mercy. Nourish her soul with patience. Comfort her with the sense of your goodness. Lift up your countenance upon her and give her peace. To Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray this prayer because of and in the name of Jesus the Christ. And all God's children say amen.
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 At this time, we prepare ourselves with a solo, a song that touches the heart of our Mother Beeman. Song one, if you came in earlier, you would hear being played. So we come to present to you at this time, I Can Only Imagine by Sister Carton Tina Cloud.
Imagine.
We extend our most humble sympathy to the family. We are deeply saddened by the loss of our dear beloved husband and lifelong companion, brother, uncle, and friend. Please know that as one people purpose serving God today, we too here feel the loss of our brother and elder church father, Mr. Eugene Beeman. As a deacon of Neal Fellowship Baptist Church, it is my sincere privilege to serve in the shadow of a few great men, Mr. Eugene Beeman. He has exemplified all that means to people and to God to be a great man. Mr. Beeman was a devoted, doting husband, father, who put his trust in God first. But his wife and son, he proved, had his utmost devotion. Even through his stay at Manicare, Mr. Beeman would hear his wife's voice, or just the name called, and his eyes would open, would gleam, and a smile would grace his face. Mr. Beeman rested in the arms of God during his stay there. Mother Beeman would reciprocate that unconditional love and an untiring effort, and she would sit by his bedside for hours each day, talking to him and praying for his comfort. She even convinced Medicare attendants to give the special elevator key so she could go up and down the elevator to be by his side. But at last, a great man, he was a faithful Dallas Cowboy fan, a man after my own heart. What about those Cowboys? Mr. Beeman filled our hearts with gladness as he left as an example of a great man's endurance and perseverance on his last visit to Near, when he victoriously joined the mighty men of Near on our Men's Day celebration in October of 2015. I will never forget that day. He was dressed sharp as can be, as all his near girlfriends buzzed around him. I don't think I've ever seen Mother Beeman more proud of her gene. Their loving relationship spanned more than five decades will remain as a guiding inspiration to myself, my wife, and to many other married couples who their lives have touched. Another great man wrote, "When great men die, the light he leaves behind lies on the path of other men that follows for years." We at Near agree. I will commit a continuous prayer that fond memories of our beloved Mr. Beeman will bring joy, peace, and comfort from the light of the life that he left behind. Mother Beeman, you know I'm your deacon, and I will be wherever you are. Whatever you need, wherever, whenever, your Near Fellowship Baptist Church will be there to continue to support you. Brother Beeman, Father Beeman, has gone to glory before us, but soon and very soon, we too are going to see the King. Our prayers for you and your family is declared in Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all the joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you all, and we pray that God will change your strength during your time of grief.
Well, let me just start out and say this is not one of my strong words. You know, many want something, and here I am. Well, I've been knowing Betty, Marvin, Gene, I want to say somewhere around 1969, somewhere. Me and Marvin became good friends. Naturally, in them days, if parents had to meet, right? And she became good friends with my parents, right? And we just stayed friends all the way. And one thing I always He was a quiet man. He didn't make it. He didn't raise his voice, right? He was stern, right? When he said something, he meant it. But he didn't have to yell at Marvin. He didn't have to scream. And that's the way we were, you know? We would be able to put in Betty's house. And we always knew one thing, that Gene was cooking, we would eat. Yeah, he would be in the back barbecuing or something, and it was time to eat, right? Always a peaceful guy, right? And through the years, right, I guess they just taught me so much, that family, right? Between my family and their family, right, that means so much. It means so much. They stuck together through times, right? And then he just one strong.
Amen.
That's all I can say. She's been through a lot, and she's one strong woman, right? And I've always looked at her like she's my little mother, right? She's always been there for me, taking care of me, strengthening me, right? So, Betty, Gene's at rest now, right? And I mean, Gene's years, he was a strong black man, right? And good father. His time is done.
Gene helped me out when I had my got my permit. He let me drive his car. He helped teach me how to drive. He took us out to Weekway Park in the dead of winter, and he knew us kids wanted to ride our sleds. He took us all the way over to Weekway Park. I mean, he would do those kinds of things and spend all day with us. So I'm going to miss Gene. I love him. He's like a father to me. Betty Jean, you know, I'm always here. She's gone on to a better place. Love you, Jean.
Amen. Thank God for those heartfelt words shared that, you know, definitely we all share here. I stand as the pastor of Mother Beeman and Brother Beeman. And I'm just so honored and blessed to be their pastor. And so many of you have been a blessing in helping them along the way. You know, lest we not forget, you know, all that has been done. You know, and I'd like to thank our official ministry and those of the diaconate and the trustees. Went out of their way to make sure, you know, Mike and I talked a lot. We talked a lot about how, as a church, we've been there, you know, for Betty and been there for Brother Gene. But they would not have come this way if it had not been for Brother Session, Reverend Session. Thank God for them bringing them this way and lifting them up, caring for them, and then the church joining in with them and hoping to take care of their needs. That's what church people are supposed to be about, amen?
Amen?
And that's what friends are supposed to be about. And so join me and just put your hands together for those who put a hand and take care of Brother Peter. We thank God for you. And God has a special blessing for those who offer and give their services beyond what we normally do. I believe his nurse is here from Medicare. If that's you, wave your hand. Yeah, that's her. Put your hand together and her here. It just speaks to the life. I knew that would bring a smile to Mother Beamer's face. It's just important at these times, you know, for the loved one who is here. You know, Gene can't hear us, but it's good for the loved one who is here to know that there is still comfort and there is support. Amen?
Amen.
I came to Newark in 1966 and moved on a block where Betty Beamer and Gene Beamer were. And their son Marvin was pretty much, he was 5 years older than me, but he was my role model. So I can't stop thanking them for having him, because he and I, in a block of three blocks, he and I were the only two African-American males to go to a four-year college in those three blocks. So we thank God for that. You know, so those are my reflections when I can still hear Betty Beamer yelling, "Marvin!" You know, before the street lights went out. And she could hear my mother saying, "Alfonso!" You know, so that's when we had the neighborhoods then. Neighborhoods then, where people knew each other and had respect for one another. Amen?
Amen.
So at this time, we make way for resolutions and acknowledgments coming from our church clerk, Sister Pat Session, and the reading of the obituary.
Lady Gwen, members of the clergy, officers, friends and family from near and far, beloved Beamer family, beloved in the Lord, good morning. On behalf of the family, they have received numerous expressions of sympathy, which will be acknowledged at a later time. For now, they have asked that I share the following. The Lord is with you during this difficult time. Thinking of you and praying that you may find comfort and strength in his word and his love, with deepest sympathy, the Deacon's Ministry. With deepest sympathy on the loss of your husband. May the warm and loving memories of your partner and friend console and comfort you and bring you courage for the days ahead. This is from the Deacon's Ministry. Your loved one will always be remembered. Mother Beamer, we will always remember Gene Beamer and the love you have for Gene. May it console you to know others care. Think of you warmly and in every prayer. Ask God to bless you with courage to bear the sorrow that now fills your heart. With deepest sympathy, Pastor and Lady Gwen Platt. Would the members of NEA please stand as I share the memorial from the NEA Fellowship Baptist Church. To Mother Beamer and the family of the late Eugene Beamer, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the saints. If we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. According to his tender mercies, God, in his infinite wisdom, has seen fit to move from labor to reward our beloved Brother Beamer. The NEA Fellowship Baptist Church bows in humble submission to his will as we rely upon him for comfort during this time of loss. We come together to pay our respects to the memory of one whose life was full of love, one who lived in such a manner that touched each and every one of us with his great example of acceptance. The NEA Fellowship Church family wants the family to know that Brother Beamer's passing has left us deeply saddened. Our hearts are with you as we bid goodbye to our beloved brother and friend, a man of wisdom, but of few words, whose warm smile captured the hearts of those who would come into his presence. We embrace the family because we share a common bond that will connect us for the rest of our lives. While we recognize that your loss is deep and your sorrow is great, in the hearts of those who knew Brother Beamer, His memory lives. He will be missed, but not forgotten. Brother Beeman was a very proud, independent person whose love for his family was evident in all that he did. Brother Beeman cheered loudest for his wife, our beloved Mother Beeman, and their son Marvin. Family, on behalf of the Neo Fellowship Baptist Church, we pray that you will find comfort in these words. No matter what your trials are, or how big your mountain seems, the Lord is there to see you through. He'll go to all extremes. So if your cross seems hard to bear, and you know not what to do, the one who loves you most of all will be there to see you through. This is sorrowfully submitted, the Neo Fellowship Baptist Church, Pastor Alphonsus and Lady Gwen Platt, past session church clerk. Beloved, let us consider the obituary. Eugene James Beeman, eldest son of the late Valerie and Emma Beeman, was born in Dallas, Texas on January 17, 1931. Following an extended illness, he departed this life on Saturday, January 6, 2018, at the Manor Care Nursing Facility in Mountainside, New Jersey. Gene, as he was affectionately called, was educated in the Dallas public school system. After graduation, he relocated to Colorado for a brief period, where he honed his culinary skills, eventually working as a chef. He never lost his joy of cooking over the years and continued being right at home in the kitchen as he enjoyed baking for his family. Gene would later relocate to New Jersey and served as a long-distance truck driver for the Harry Knorr Meat Company for well over 30 years. He met the love of his life, Betty, in 1960, and after a brief courtship, they were married in 1961. Gene adopted Betty's son, the late Marvin Dawson, and the three lived a happy, healthy, and satisfying life for many years. Gene loved his family and found joy in spending time with them and telling any and everyone who would listen about his wife. In fact, Gene's friends joked that he thought he was the only one to ever have a wife. Raised in Dallas, Texas, it was only natural that Gene would be a Dallas Cowboys fan. He was fun-loving, friendly, and never met a stranger. His quiet demeanor spoke volumes to the hearts of those who knew and loved him. Gene and Betty joined the Neo Fellowship Baptist Church under the pastorate of their longtime friend, the Reverend Alphonsus Platt, whom they watched grow up as a young man in Newark, New Jersey neighborhood in which they lived many years ago. They loved to reminisce with Pastor Platt about the various experiences he and their son Marvin had while growing up. Gene was delighted to have his son's friend from the neighborhood as his pastor. Gene leaves to cherish his fond memory, Betty, his wife of 57 years, two brothers, William and Jesse Beeman, Dallas, Texas, one sister, Dorothy Beeman, Sherman, Texas, one sister-in-law, Mildred Wallace, Bloomfield, New Jersey, four nieces, Deborah, Phil Lamore, and Joyce Ann Beeman, Dallas, Texas. Tracy Smith, her husband Gerard, Hampton, Georgia. Thelma Wallace, Bloomfield, New Jersey. Five nephews, Stephen Beeman, Richard Beeman Jr., and Bobby Hill of Dallas, Texas. Michael Swain, his wife Angie, of San Antonio, Texas, and Eric Swain of Georgia, the Neo Fellowship Baptist Church family, and many other family members, neighbors, and friends. Gene was preceded in death by one brother, Richard Beeman Sr. Since you'll never be forgotten, we pledge to you today, a hallowed place within our hearts is where you'll always stay. Good night, our dear brother. We will see you in the morning. The family of Eugene Beeman expresses deep gratitude to the entire staff of the Manor Care Rehabilitation Facility in Mountainside, New Jersey, the Neo Fellowship Baptist Church family, Sandwiches Unlimited, Orange, New Jersey. To the many friends and family who have been faithful during the illness and passing of our loved one, and now share our grief and bereavement in kind words, cards, prayers, and other courtesies, we pray that God will continue to bless each of you. Lovingly, the Beeman family. Good morning.
Amen. Thank God for those of you who sent resolutions and the announcements. And what a wonderful, wonderful obituary speaks of a life. But only as Betty Beeman would have it, she would bring someone here to sing a solo whose voice I haven't heard in a long time. And we are so delighted that we have our own Nakia Daniel, who is coming to bring us a selection, Amazing Grace. After that, you will hear none other than Betty's pastor doing the eulogy.
Amazing grace, how
just went to church. Somebody needs, oh my God, somebody needs to be praising God right about now. I don't know about you, but I got to praise him because I'm full right about now. I got to give him the glory for all that he's done. So somebody don't know about God's grace. Brother Mike's playing it with God's grace yesterday morning. Getting ready to go in to have the viewing when Betty was struggling with being able to go in to see him. But it was God's grace and his mercy. Oh, come on, somebody. Looked at Evangelist Hendricks and said, won't he do it? My. Just so full when the gospel music is the music of good news. And when it's a testimony to what has already taken place, it is such a blessing. I'm not caught up in what I need to say. I already told him yesterday, I preached half of my eulogy to Mother Beeman's sister and a niece yesterday, just at the funeral home. And I'm just so full, and I'm thankful that God has kept her to be able to have the strength to do what needs to be done. We want you to open your Bibles. There is a word from the Lord, and it's somewhat colored with my personality. Tussle with the Lord about what should we say. And he would take us to the book of Romans, familiar portion of scripture, the 8th chapter of Romans, starting at the 35th verse. The 8th chapter of Romans, you'll find it in the Second Testament, starting at the 35th verse. This is yet somewhat difficult for me, you know, even being the pastor, is difficult when someone close to you leaves here. And yet I try to frame it in the right frame of mind, you know, with the family, and try to keep myself lifted up lightly. You know, it's even difficult for me because I'm a Giants fan. Yeah. And I hear about those Cowboys. But it gets worse. Because Mike is from San Antonio, and he's a Spurs fan, and I'm a Cavaliers fan, go figure. But we will get through it, amen. Romans 8:35, and the word of the Lord reads, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And the word of the Lord is blessed. If I were to tag this text, it would be entitled, Captured by God's Love. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for your mercy and we thank you for your grace. God, even in a time such as this, we know that you're still a good God. Now, God, I ask that you would stand up and sit me down. Hide me behind the cross so that the people can see you and not me. Let me not be insulted. But, God, I respect this calling and what you've called me to. So, God, let your words speak to these, your people. Let them be comforted. Let them be blessed. But most of all, someone who does not know you, let this word drive them closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Today is a difficult day because we suffer the loss on this side of a good man by the name of Gene Beeman, who is a blessing to his family. But I need you to know that we're not here because Gene Beeman died. We are here because Gene Beeman lived, and because he lived a good life and he gave his life to Christ. We celebrate the life of Gene Beeman. We're excited about his life because it wasn't just any life. It was a life that was dwelled within the Lord. And if the Bible is right, the Bible teaches us that we should cry when babies come into the world. But we should rejoice when those we know are going home to be with the Lord. Our tears should be interrupted by our smiles and praise, because Gene Beeman was a man of God who was a great role model for all men, whether they were married or whether they were single. Somebody said, a good man is hard to find. But our church mother, Betty, she found her man. Amen. She found a man that was not ashamed of his love for his wife and his son. Gene Beeman's life was a pure demonstration of the power of love. He loved himself, Betty. And he loved himself so Marvin. When you saw them all together, you could tell that this family union was ordained by God. I see you smiling, Mother Beeman. I'm going to bring it. You know I'm going to bring it. You always saying, what pastor say about me today? Well, I got you up in here. Isn't it amazing that even though some things are ordered by God, it takes a little time to see it for ourselves. Sometimes God even tries to give us a hint, and we mess that up by not noticing what God is trying to do. So while I was preparing this eulogy, I thought about Mother Beeman and how determined and how tough she is. My. I thought about how smart and how astute she is when it comes to her own well-being. And then I said, wait a minute. How did Gene Beeman snatch her up? You know she had to be one of those, child, please. She had to be a hard catch. God had to be in this. Then I said, I need to share a spiritual connection and say to the people that God put them together before the foundation of the world. And yes, I believe he did that. But if you know something about me, sometimes my spiritual revelation gets flooded with my own humor. The more I thought about Mother Beeman, all I can hear was her nephew Mike Swain's voice in the back of my head from the many conversations we had. And I could hear him saying, as he usually does, well, Pastor, you know my Aunt Betty Jean. And then I said, there it is, Betty Jean. No wonder Gene loved his mother-in-law so much and loved Betty so much. He was thanking her for putting him and Betty together. Betty Jean became Betty and Jean. Mike could not say Betty without saying Betty Jean. And if you ask most of us, we have come to know Betty. We can't know Betty without knowing Jean. And so I said, well, there you have it, Betty Jean. Yes, God was in this, because you cannot think about Betty without thinking about Jean. God was trying to tell Betty her whole life that he had somebody waiting for her. This union had to be the power of the love that God expresses to all of us, because God's love is written all over it. That kind of love is strong and it's binding, and it's something that for 57 years all of us should long to have for ourselves. Gene could not be separated from Betty, and Betty could not be separated from Gene. She couldn't be separated from Gene because every day she thought about him, and every day he thought about her. Every day their love brought them closer with every challenge and every trial that they had to come through. You all know what I'm talking about when you have to come closer and closer to somebody. You all know what I'm talking about when you think about being close to the person that you love. And I know you are listening to me coming from the pulpit speaking to you, but you're not so holy that you can't remember those songs that really told a story about love. Well, I can see it in the smile on your faces. I want to tell nobody about the love song that you're thinking about. Let me just share this. In the words of Carolyn Wiggum on just yesterday, she said she didn't know Gene and Betty from a can of paint. But once she experienced their presence, she knew they were something else back in the day. She looked at Betty and said, I just know you were just, I don't know what it is, but you were something else. Mother Beamer had her walk and she rocked and said, yeah, child, I'm something else. And as I thought about that, I said, well, I'm sure Gene and Betty had some Roberta Flack and Donnie Hathaway moments. Yeah, y'all not that old, right? Oh, yeah. Remember the closer I get to you? When she sang, I only could imagine, I know it's I only could imagine a whole lot of things. I can just imagine Betty and Gene's moments. I looked at the words and I said, oh, here they go. The closer I get to you, the more you make me see. By giving me all you got, your love has captured me. In other words, you're stepping over and over again. I try to tell myself that we could never be more than friends. And all the while inside, I knew it was real. The way you make me feel. Lying here next to you, time just seems to fly. Needing you more and more. Jesus, let's give love a try. Sweeter than sweeter love grows, and heaven's there for those who fool the tricks of time. With the hearts of love, they find true love in a special way. Yes, Gene and Betty found true love in a special way. Gene was not only captured by Betty's love, but he was captured by the love of God. And that helped him capture and dedicate his life even more so to Betty. When Gene gave his life to Christ, that took his love for Betty to a whole nother level. Most people saw Gene Beeman as a quiet, gentle giant of a man in Betty's life. But he let everybody know Betty was his wife. And he said in the obituary to the point that most people began to say, Gene, you're not the only one with a wife. That's love. And that's the power of love. And that's the love that God gives us. And so many times we get so caught up in ourselves that we forget about that. So that's why Paul tells us, I'm in the book, y'all. In the text, Paul says, out of the kinds of things that cannot separate us. Paul tells us that all these things that can't separate us from the love of Christ, and they are the sort of things that have happened during Gene and Betty's journey in the last seasons of their life. In the midst of Gene's illness, there was always Paul's question, shall tribulation or distress, shall persecution or famine, shall nakedness or peril or sword separate me from the love of God? And I can hear Paul saying to him in the word, no. The reason Paul chose to mention those terrible things was to make sure that we knew what he was saying, and he wanted us to know, well, there are not something so horrible that can separate us from the love of God. He's saying nothing can separate us from the love of God. Paul said defiantly, nothing can separate us from God's love. When we get close to God. And that's why it's so important for us to get closer and closer to God so that we are that glue that is connected with him. Gene was so captured by God's love that Gene didn't just love Betty and Marvin. He loved his mother-in-law too. In fact, he loved her with the same passion. I think he and I would talk a lot about that because I love my mother-in-law in the same way. And sometimes I think Betty might have thought her mother loved Marvin more than she loved her. I made the mistake of telling him how much I loved my mother-in-law in a conversation, and he wore me out about how good his mother-in-law was to him. So I said, well, my mother-in-law spoiled me with her cooking, and he said, my mother-in-law spoiled me more. He would not let my mother-in-law be better than his, and I wanted to say, you are not the only one who had a mother-in-law. His quiet demeanor spoke volumes about the kind of love that he was captured by. And see, it's not, you know, the whole expressive thing, because sometimes we get so caught up in religion and we get caught up in the acts of religion, and we try to show people with our deeds, and we try to show people with what we do about God's love. But sometimes God's love is just quiet. And all you got to do is watch the person, because see, sometimes we think we come to God and we make that decision, but no, God is working on us all day long and all night long. And when Gene got ready to come to the Lord, he came to the Lord right. He didn't come to the Lord wanting to be boastful. He didn't come to the Lord wanting to stick his chest out. He didn't come to the Lord wanting to be important. He just came to the Lord with God's love all over him. And that made a difference. Do I have any witnesses here? Does that make the difference when you come to God right? We are all here today because of our love for Gene, but you need to know before you leave here today that Gene's life was an example for all of us. His life models Paul's definition of love. If you go to 1 Corinthians 13 and 4, you can see what Paul's definition of love was. And so I just threw Gene in there, and you're going to see how Paul kind of mirrored the definition of love and how Gene lived a life that I could just fit his name right in. Gene was patient. Gene was kind. Gene did not envy. Gene did not boast. Gene was not proud to a fault. Gene did not dishonor others. Gene was not self-seeking. Gene was not easily angered. Gene did not readily keep a record of the wrongs that were done to him. Gene did not delight in evil. He rejoiced in the truth. Gene always protected his family. Gene always trusted his family. Gene always lived with hope. Gene never failed his family. Gene was able to do this because Gene became the love that God put inside of him. And I'm so glad I met Gene, because I met God's love. So if you're here today and you love Gene, it should be easy for you to love God. Gene was our example of love, the kind of love that God gives all of us. Gene is with the Lord now, so his example of love should drive all of us to live a better life and how we love God. If you have not accepted Christ as your personal Savior, if you have not accepted Christ into your life and experienced God's love, today is the day to do it. You wondered why you showed up. I told you, you didn't come because he died. You came because he lived. And because he lived, he must have affected your life. And so if you're here and you don't know God, you need to get to know God. Because if you like something about Gene, then you like something about God. Because sometimes God has to put himself inside of other people so that other people will realize the goodness of Jesus. You know how the preachers say it, and I don't just say it just to be saying it, but when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, I can't help it, but my soul cries out, hallelujah. God, I thank you for saving me. I thank you for taking me and turning me inside out. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. And when you begin to thank God for that, then you can feel the love of God. Has anybody ever felt the love of God in here today? God and his love is something to be captured by. It's something to be engulfed by. And it's something that when you walk out of here today, I know we're sad, but I keep telling my congregation, when you feel the goodness of God and you walk out of here, you need to be a light in the community. His life is going to be a light in the community. The dash between the time that Gene was born and the time that Gene died is going to be a light to someone. Oh, it might not be to you, but when I think about him, I think about the light that shines because of what he was able to do. Again, not because he did so much that I can see, but because of his presence. And there's something about when there's something good about you, you don't have to brag about it. I always worry about the people who talk a whole lot, because people who say a whole lot, they're not about nothing anyway. And sometimes the quiet folk, you notice the people who always talk about money, they don't have money. But the quiet folks are the ones who got a pocket full of money. And
so the people who always talk about joy, I'm blessed and I'm highly favored and everything is good, those are not always the people who are blessed, because those are the first ones to get upset and start cussing people out. It's the people who are quiet and just sit there and say, I got hope, I got joy, I got peace, and God is going to deliver me from whatever situation I'm in. So if you're here and you love Gene, it should be easy for you. Mother Beeman, I know you're going to miss him, but remember, you missed him before. You missed him when he went to Medicare, but God made a way for you to see him whenever you could. When you can jump into that Cadillac and drive the parkway and hit Route 22, you were able to. And then when you couldn't do that and you had to get a ride, you were able to. And then in your own stubbornness, when you didn't want to listen to nobody, not even the doctor, he said, I'll fix you. I'm going to put you right there next to him. And then you had the whole Medicare taking you upstairs and taking you downstairs. God has a way. So I know you're going to miss him, but it was about his spirit. It wasn't about his body. God connected you with his spirit, and just like he made a way for you to get there, you're going to get there again, because the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Gene's body is here for our closure, but his spirit is with the Lord. Do I have the witnesses here? Oh, instead of Medicare, he's in God's care. So it's all right, Betty. You still have access to Gene. All you have to do is enter into his presence. Enter into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. That is where you will find Gene, because nothing can separate you from the love of God. And the love of God was in Gene. It's okay to cry. That's all right. You will cry from time to time. But don't forget to thank God for Gene. That is what I'm going to do. I'm going to thank God for capturing Gene with his love. Thank you, God, for sending me a strong man, a man of some integrity, a man of some strength. Not because he showed it and what he did, but he showed it and how he lived. Thank God for giving you a good husband. Thank God for Gene. Thank God for giving you a good father for your son. Thank God for Gene. Thank God for giving you a good provider. Thank God for Gene. Gene held on for you, Betty, because he wanted you to be stronger. He held it together so you can come and whisper in his ear. Thank God for Gene. He held it together, and now he's going from labor to reward. Gene was your knight in shining armor. Gene was your king, but now your king is with the King of Kings. He's with the Lord of Lords. Praising God. Come on, Betty. Let's celebrate. God has been good. King Gene is getting his crown. Oh, I can see him putting on his crown. Saying, I got it, Betty. No more pain. He's got his crown. No more sorrow. He's got his crown. No more struggles. He's got his crown. Gene is captured by God's love. He will be with us in the spirit. And he will be with you, Betty, in the spirit. The reason he will be with us is because we all love God. And the reason he will be with you, Betty, is because you love God too. Nothing, nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Gene was captured by God's love. Come on, give God some praise. His mercy. As I invite the funeral directors to come, we're going to have a final viewing. We're going to ask the musician to just play the music to take me to the King, as we give the family their final opportunity to say their goodbye to their loved one. It was his love that gave them strength. And it's going to be his love that will keep them strong.
Those who have designated themselves as pallbearers to join in with our funeral director so that you can help us as we prepare to move the casket. If you are yet in place, just please make yourselves known to our funeral director so that you can join in with the family. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying, no more crying. We are going to see the King. No more.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.